some of the broad critiques that have come up are that they have been, strike to water discourse has in fact been very individualistic. So you look at individuals as bearers of rights. So there's one school of thought that thinks about it. I'm just putting forward the critiques before you. Also that the whole declaration of human rights and the human rights discourse, so it's very contextualized in the Western context and not so much in the Asian or Indian context, is another critique. The third critique is around how citizens are seen as central. So the right actually revolves around your political membership or political citizenship, basically. So what happens to those who are migrating, the migrants who are not necessarily qualified as citizens? So that is also one of the critiques as to how are you really going to implement that right when the population is a moving population. And the sort of stronger critique has been that it lays a very sort of a universal moral framework. So again, the same thing of context, that within, say, Indian context, maybe communities have a better understanding of how they're going to navigate through their rights, simply as what you said. This is a universal right which does not allow for that kind of a navigation. So I have a universal moral framework. You know? So let communities decide, or let context decide, was also one of the critiques. I think all of it we can also contest, and there have been very strong contestations. So the problem that we discussed, if communities were allowed to navigate, is this whole question of what do you do with the inequities then? There is caste, there's patriarchy, there is class, ethnic groups, religious minorities. So community actually is all of this. So how do you really deal with that? So at one level, it's fine to say that, you know, you don't want that universal overarching moral framework, but it often means that then you continue with the exploitative forms that are already existing. So do you sort of, how do you negotiate that? So these are some of the sort of broad critiques, and I think there is already a lot of thinking around that, and therefore the debate is so much more complex. So it's not as simple as, you know, legislate it, or even although the UN has said that right to water, the treaty should be signed by different countries, merely signing that is not really going to help us unpack that and try and implement that in the different contexts that we are in, the diverse contexts that we are in. So that is something that I think it's not, I would not say that it's a resolved kind of issue. You know, this 40 LPCD is that basic right. But Delhi is one example, I think, that there was something that cut across communities. In a sense, this whole universalization, you know, like, don't have targeted PDS, a similar kind of a thing. But as Vishwanath pointed in our discussion yesterday, PDS is different. It's a different resource. And water is. So you really need to understand the characteristics of water and then try and navigate through the inequities. So I think that's something that we need to be continually thinking about, and in our own work, trying to look for these issues, engage in debates with local communities and groups who are trying to address inequities in terms of access to water. In Maharashtra, this whole entitlement, this understanding of rights in the context of irrigation is sort of enshrined in the Maharashtra Regulatory Authority law, the act that we have, Water Resources Regulatory Act, where an entitlement actually, the way it is defined, it's an authorization either by the regulatory authority or the river basin agency that is still yet in place. So that's how an entitlement is defined. The way it's actually got down to the ground is that as we discussed yesterday, it was supposed to be a bulk water entitlement. So you have categories of users who are industries, only three categories, by the way. So we have industries, we have domestic sector, and we have agriculture. So there is no thinking beyond these three categories, which the law understands. And then within these categories, there is a bulk water entitlement that is made to each of these categories. As of now, we have entitlements that are in the irrigation context worked out. Supposedly, they are to be worked out for up to the individual level. That's the overall sort of part of legislation. Although the way it operates right now at the moment is that there are wherever the water users associations have been formed, it operates at the water users association level. So there is an entitlement which is given to a particular water users association, and that entitlement then is in terms of a volume. This is the quantum of water based on the command area of that particular water users association, typically in Maharashtra, a minor canal, say up to 400 hectares of land, or not more than that, usually. So that is what an entitlement is. And then, since it's in proportion with the land, the understanding is that people also within the water users association use that accordingly. So in very much in proportion to land. Now this is something that in a way this law has legislated. Perhaps earlier there were different kinds of arrangements working. So in a sense, this has formalized that land to water relationship. That if you have so much land, you have so much entitlement. Not that the practices were very different earlier, but there were possibilities, and in some cases there are also examples of how during a period of scarcity, people have probably shared their water in a different way, and not necessarily in proportion to their land. So maybe this year is a bad year, so your entitlement is low, so then you probably take water only for 1 acre of your land. But this, in a sense, the MWRRA has formalized and said that no, water right will be in proportion to your land, which is a matter of, you know, then the whole question of if you legislate in a particular way, do you freeze rights and freeze understandings around rights without allowing for a review or without allowing for that informal understanding that probably existed earlier, or probably there was a potential to explore for those informal improving access to, you know, the poor or the marginal and small landholders within that command area. So that's something that we really need to be looking at when we look at this whole question of legislation and extent can we go into legislating equity? Does it actually leave out spaces of informal negotiations where people have tried to equitably work out the arrangements? And these are examples of that, where we discussed a lot on tradability of rights, but how even in the case of Gujarat, where initially, in fact, in Gujarat, it was a very interesting way that AKRSP and others and it had intervened, and they had asked for a nominal membership of women to water users associations, in which a lot of women actually participate in the decision-making processes of the irrigation commands. But with a formal law, you actually exclude certain people, that only landholders will become members of the water users associations. Now in Maharashtra this has always been the case, but in Gujarat before the law there were some interventions that actually did allow for opening up of participation from women across the community. So whether these, you know, what are really the pros and cons of trying to legislate the way equity is understood by the state and articulated by the people who justify that this is the understanding around equity. So I think there are issues around that. Very clearly what has always been the case is that command area understanding is focused on landholders within command areas. So it has historically excluded the landless populations and also those that actually fall outside of the command areas. So whether that sort of a, you know, if there wasn't that kind of a legislation, whether it would have been possible to have those kind of exchanges where, in fact, in Maharashtra, the example of FUD is often used, the FUD irrigation system, although there were a lot of exploitative forms within that, and it's not that the Dalits and other scheduled castes and landless were allowed access to water, but still it was a system where you had a pool of land which could be irrigated and which a large number of farmers from the habitat had access to. Now this is a different kind of an example of equity, but But as I would say, the historically disadvantaged groups were still not part of that. So we need to be thinking about some of these issues. And we've covered a lot in the discussion on how civil society responses have been. And I think what both Shripad and Joy were saying, that articulations have been very different and very context specific. So understandings around equity have actually emerged in the context that people have been, the groups have been. So you have example of Pani Panchayat, which was also discussed a lot yesterday, where how within that context the principles that were developed were actually engaging with the local context at one level and trying to address the whole question of inequities in access to water across the landed and landless groups. The South Maharashtra example was also, I think, discussed a lot. What was not discussed are these three, four other examples, which I'll just discuss and stop after that. One is what SOPECOM itself was trying to do, work out sort of develop norms around how equity actually can be extended outside of the command areas and to include landless and women. This was in the southern, southeastern Maharashtra, so Marathwada area bordering Karnataka and Andhra on one side. And here the idea was that there is an irrigation, a surface irrigation project, and one of the minor canals actually runs through this particular village where a users association was formed. The difference was that in this WUA, we tried to negotiate with the landowners that you need to, this has come through a huge amount of public investment. The canal itself, the dam, and your access to water has come up as a result of a huge public investment. And therefore, this needs to be shared across different groups. And that is, there was a lot of contestation that this is our water, why should we share it, etc. But the broader understanding was that, I mean, how the agreement finally came up was that first that it's a public investment, and the second important thing was that if this kind of an intervention was not done, probably you wouldn't have access to the water that you have today. So because the Water Users Association was formed, because there was a lot of negotiation with the state, as a result of which even that quantum of water that was available to that group was possible. So because of both of these reasons, you need to extend that access to the landless and to women who do not fall in the traditional command area of that Water Users Association. Now, there was a contract that was signed. The legality of it was, a whole lot of questions can be asked. But I think it was a step forward in terms of an understanding that developed between the landless and women and the Water Users Association. So obviously there are costs for equity. So actually pumping that water out of the command area from the canal into a buffer storage, etc., are costs that you need to incur. But the point is that you can make a policy statement. You should be able to make this kind of a policy statement where there is a huge public investment and therefore this right needs to extend to others in that habitat. So including then what kind of arrangements, whether you sell that water right or whether you use that water on either a shared basis within the command areas or outside of the command areas through use of fallow lands, were different options that we looked at. Unfortunately, fertile lands in the command areas was not something that farmers agreed to. So the women's group had to, in fact, take on land which was fallow almost more than 20 years. And that was grazing land which they had a contractual understanding for 15 years. Now, all of this also needs to be seen in the context of employment generation programs, how schemes like NREGA could actually support asset building if water as an asset was shared with them. Are various arrangements one needs to also be talking about. This is not a one-off experiment, right? It has to be, first of all, at the policy level accepted, and secondly, there has to be some groundswell around it. There has to be some mobilization and people accepting. There has to be a social carrier to these ideas. As we discussed yesterday, you cannot just have a law. I mean, probably in Maharashtra, the only step they moved ahead as a result of all of this intervention was that, okay, we'll have, you know, 33% on the committees of water users associations. But they still will be landholders within command areas. So all of that did not really change. But allowing for these kind of experimentations is also maybe a step forward. But what will be the social carrier is something that we need to be thinking about. A similar kind of a thing also happened in Orissa, that whole PIM phase where the entire water users association was taken over by women. So, you know, they said, we need the water, we are actually managing our lands, so we will determine access, we will determine its distribution and allocations. So, there are myriad such examples, Bundelkhand women's, I already discussed yesterday, where in their own context, civil society has been responding to the kinds of subordination and exploitation that has been taking place and articulating a demand in, again, a very relative term. The whole understanding around equity and the right may change over a period of time, probably with a change in social dynamics, power relations, or simply if there is a more favorable law which they can use as a space to, you know, as a tool to actually negotiate and fight for their right. So what I think one should conclude with in this whole context of equity is that, first of all, of course, that legislation alone is not enough, and do not have, to say that, okay, if class, caste, gender was not addressed together, that this is not an equitable kind of a program. But there have been attempts where there have been, you know, definite understandings around what is exploitation, what is subordination, and in the context of water, what kind of a struggle could be waged. I think in their own context, it's going to be different. The situations are going to be different. It's not only going to be, you know, that 100 LPCD per capita per day, that's not sharing of that equitably. Again, the whole question of delinking of land rights and water rights, but not in the context of that looked at yesterday. But ensuring a minimum, but how we understand is that ensuring minimum water service for livelihood needs to all and on an affordable terms, irrespective of land holding. So much of this we have discussed already, but I think I would like to leave you with this understanding of how inequities across social groups need to be understood, need to be addressed, but also the fact that equity is not a simple concept, or right to water is not a simple thing to implement, but the complexities have to be understood if we need to really seriously look at addressing inequities and furthering the cause of social justice.